Thank you. Good morning, and thank you so much, Lenny, for inviting me. I don't particularly enjoy such long journeys, but Lenny's very persuasive and a great host, and I think this is a great meeting. So I have a few opening remarks. One of the things he kept saying was, like, controversial. And I don't know whether it was directed at me personally or whether he wanted the whole meeting to be controversial, but I'm going to do my best. So I've got a couple of opening remarks which have occurred to me while I'm sitting here. So for anybody who's a music fan, there's a Paul Weller song, and one of the lines is, "The more I see, the more I know, the less I understand." And that is a little bit like what's going on here, because we all see a lot and we all know a lot, but we're in an era of not fully understanding. And the only thing I can say in my favour is that, well, even if I don't understand, they still have opinions. So I'm going to give you a little bit of opinion, and I think sometimes opinions is all what we have. And the second thing is that I heard yesterday that people younger than me have been designated as a vulnerable population. And that made me laugh a bit, really, because I'm now the one who has to hold the handrail while I'm walking in high heels. And I'm certainly a lot more vulnerable now than I was when I was a so-called adolescent and young adult. And I'm also the mother of an adolescent and young adult. So should I get ALL and die, I've left someone else vulnerable. So I'm not sure, really, that I don't think it's a good idea to designate any age or population as being more special than another. There are different issues at different ages, but it does annoy me a little bit that, you know, so-and-so's getting all the attention, because there's different issues, and I'm here in a way to try and represent the issues of older people. So both of the things that I'm going to talk about while I'm here concern people that are probably in their 50s and 60s, and that should really hopefully appeal to quite a bit of the audience here. So I'm going to focus today on, I was asked to talk a little bit about allogeneic transplant, and that's something that it's somewhat of a dirty word in treating children with ALL, and its role has become very difficult to disentangle as we've compressed these ages, you know, into saying so-and-so should have a paediatric regimen, and then you can also be too old to have a transplant. But we still do these things, so I want to talk about whether we think there is sufficient evidence to support carrying out allogeneic transplant in older adults with ALL. So I'm going to just talk a little bit about age-related outcome and why and how it impacts our decision-making. And I'm going to talk a little bit about myeloablative allografting and how we've arrived at this issue of using reduced intensity conditioning in older individuals. And in fact, there are very little published data, and I'll summarise those published data. I'll mention some prospective ongoing studies that are being carried out in this area, and in particular, obviously, the one that that we're carrying out in the UK, because I have a little bit of data that I can share with you, and also discuss whether we think the novel immunological approaches can challenge and possibly replace allografting in ALL. So I've got a couple of controversial things to say about the superior efficacy of paediatric therapeutic regimens. So absolutely clear that if you treat younger people, by and large, with these more intensive so-called paediatric regimens, they have a better outcome. But it's absolutely important to remind everybody that there have never been any randomized comparisons. And the most convincing data that we have are from concurrent adult and paediatric trials in which patients of the same age could, in a country, have received either regimen. And so there's a lot of selection bias at work there, because you're 15 years of age and you look like you're 21. You know, there was a lot of people elected to put people into either a paediatric or an adult regimen, and it wasn't those choices which were made were actual choices based on lots of things. And so the comparisons which have been done are interesting, and this is just an illustration from one of the papers that was published in the UK. So in the UK at the time, there were two regimens open, UCAL 12 and an ALL 97, and 15 to 17 year olds. So the adult trial went down to 15 years of age, and the paediatric trial went up to 18 years of age. So if you were 15 to 17, you could have been placed onto either of those trials. And if you look at this survival curves, which are shown shown here, it's a univariate analysis of outcome, it's absolutely clear that if you receive the pediatric regimen, you did a lot better than if you received the adult regimen. However, and sort of little discussed, the multivariate analysis, which is buried in the bottom of that paper, actually showed that age and Philadelphia status, but not trial treatment, were significant factors affecting the outcome. So I think even in a very narrow age range of 15 to 17-year-olds, something's happening biologically, and it's not just the treatment that's applied that affects the outcome. And so my personal contention is, and I, you know, I'm hoping that over time we'll have data to support this, and I'm not even sure the genesis of ALL is the same in a young person as it is in an older person. So we should always bear these things in mind before glibly saying, yeah, well, if we give everybody a paediatric regimen, they're going to do fine. Clearly, for some patients, dealing with these conditions in this way is a great thing to do, but for others it's extremely toxic and you don't get the outcome you want. Now, Mark Litzo showed this slide yesterday, but I've got it in here because I think it illustrates the point as well. So these are two fantastic pieces of work from the Spanish Pathema group and also from our UK and Eastern Cooperative Oncology group collaboration in the UCAL12 E993 trial. And what you can see here is two prospective studies. In this Spanish study here, patients with standard risk ALL aged 15 to 30 were subjected to a so-called pediatric regimen. And here you can see that the adolescents and the outcome for the young adults, the complete remission rate of all of those was 98%. And the overall survival of the sort of so-called young adult population aged 19 to 30, of which there were 46, was 63%. And here we have the overall survival from the donor versus no donor analysis in the UCAL12 ECOG trial. And again, the CR8 was 97%, and this applies to the 15 to 35-year-olds, and there were 323 of those. And for those who ended up having a donor, most of whom had an allogeneic transplant, the overall survival at 5 years was 62%. So as a matter of fact, those two outcomes from completely different approaches are superimposed upon one another. So if you think about that very carefully, it makes it very difficult whether, if you had someone aged 30, whether you were going to choose this so-called pediatric approach or whether you were going to choose an allogeneic transplant. And there isn't anything at the moment, I think, that would necessarily convince you that one thing is definitely the right thing to do over another. And so we're going to have to be a bit more subtle in our decision making. So one thing that I think, this isn't terribly subtle, but it's often ignored, is the role of minimal residual disease. Because when we, at the moment, we're not able to be very subtle in knowing the diagnostics and the specific lesions. Now, hopefully in 5-10 years' time, we're going to be able to do sequencing on everybody and we'll have much more personalised therapy. But as regarding at the moment, the best we can do really is to measure and quantify minimal residual disease. And that does take into account both the genetic factors and the response to therapy. So I think that's probably ignored. And this slide here is just taken from two different protocols, the adult and the pediatric protocols, which were current in the UK at the time. And this is the frequency of MRD at greater than 10 to the minus 4 as quantified by immunoglobulin and T-cell receptor gene rearrangement. And you can see at the end of initial induction, in the childhood and the adult trial, percentage of patients who are MRD positive is roughly the same. But by the time you get into the second phase of treatment, hardly any children are MRD positive, but a large proportion of adults remain MRD positive. And post-intensification, these adults are still MRD positive and very few children. So these adults are destined to do poorly because for whatever reason, biology of the patient, biology of the ALL, early on they have not responded so well to the treatment. And I just want to make a plea. We in the UK and in Europe are pretty much stuck at the moment on doing molecular quantification of MRD using patient-specific IgTCR rearrangement quantification, which has never really taken off in the United States. I think that's a great shame, actually. It's a very sensitive technique, down to 1 in 10 to the minus 5. It's quantitative. It is patient-specific and labour-intensive. But there's very good existing inter-laboratory and international cooperation for QA and standardisation. So the technique is widely standardised across a large number of countries. And presently, as far as I know, multi-parameter flow cytometry is generally less sensitive and less standardised. Obviously, deep sequencing essentially quantifies IgTCR rearrangement using a different method. And it's not clear to me at the moment, although I believe we'll have some talks on this later, whether that would be the equivalent of this. And I just wanted to show you some data from the German multicenter ALL group, looking at minimal residual disease. All of the patients portrayed here of so-called standard risk ALL, so they didn't have any of the classic known high risk factors. And you can see that having minimal residual disease separates out those who do poorly from those who do well at all time points during the course of the disease. And it's possible, based on your protocol, to try and pick an informative time point so that you can intervene. And so for the rest of the talk, the intervention that I will talk about will be bone marrow transplantation. So to focus it a little bit, to older adults, this cartoon here shows what happened to adults who were over the age of 55 who were treated in the UCAL12 E2993 study. And the first thing that I want to note is that of 100 patients aged over 55 years who were entered into that trial, 18 of them died during induction. So that's unheard of in childhood ALL and will be completely unacceptable. So, but it's actually what happens. So in most older individuals, the induction regimens that we're using are very difficult to tolerate. So saying, well, we're going to intensify and we're going to do this, that and the other. If you do have any good post-remission therapies, you won't be able to apply them if you've killed this many patients during induction. And at the end, only 20 patients were alive. And prognostic factors, one of the main prognostic factors was if you had a significant infection during induction. So most of these people are succumbing to serious infections, and that goes back a bit to the point that Dan was making about using myelosuppressive therapy, which is probably not the appropriate thing to do, particularly in older adults. So we've got to get away from the idea of thinking that you somehow need to have people flat on their backs and with actually no bone marrow function, because this is largely what kills older people during induction. But there's an interesting philosophical point here. This is the outcome of a so-called very intensive regimen applied to older individuals by the Dutch-Belgian group, HOVON. And what you can see here is that they applied this regimen, which is quite intensive, up to the age of 70 years of age. Complete remission rate declines a little bit with age, but you can see that induction death in the older individuals is actually very high. But overall, the outcome is not too bad for an older group of patients. So it's a philosophical issue about whether it may be appropriate to generate an enormous amount of toxicity for a good outcome for a small proportion of patients, or whether we do need to be just cleverer about what we do. But one of the points from this slide is that allogeneic transplantation was used as continuation therapy in quite a few of these older individuals, and even in the 61 to 70-year-old age group, there was a significant proportion of individuals who had an allogeneic transplant as their follow-on therapy. So just going to spend the next few slides exploring whether this is or isn't a good thing to do. So allogeneic transplantation is arguably the most active anti-ALL therapy currently available, but it's undoubtedly the most toxic. And what sort of information do we have on whom it's valid to? So obviously, the issue of what the age should be as to whether you can have an allogeneic transplantation is a very important one under consideration now. Because if we can do very well in younger individuals using chemotherapy approaches, then that's the appropriate thing to do. But there is some useful data on the toxicity and so forth, so we'll discuss that. I'm going to show you a slide about relapsed ALL in adults. I think it's absolutely certain to me that if you're going to use an allogeneic transplant in ALL, there's absolutely no point in waiting till the patient has relapsed. So we need to select patients appropriately. But as to all of these things, it's beyond the scope of my talk today. We're going to talk a little bit about myeloablative versus reduced intensity conditioning, but as to what's an appropriate donor, what the role of T-cell depletions, the role of post-bone marrow transplant interventions, such as DLI or tyrosine kinase inhibitors or other drugs, is not something that I can address here today. And there are actually scant data, conflicting data, on quite a few of these things. So one point that I would like to make straight off is that the largest ever prospective study of allogeneic transplantation in ALL was the UCAL12 ECOG2993 study, which showed in a very large so-called biological randomization, because in that study it was prior the widespread use of unrelated donors. So patients who, this was based on whether patients had a sibling donor or not. And so some of the patients who had a donor did not proceed to transplant. Very few of the patients who had no sibling donor proceeded to transplant. So if anything, this underestimates the value here. But there's a statistically significant difference in favour of having a donor. And that's a very large number of patients, and that persists out there at 10 years. So that's a fairly convincing piece of data. However, it hasn't convinced most people, because now the thing is, well, it probably doesn't pertain because your chemotherapy wasn't any good. So you can do this very large time-consuming studies and come out with some fairly convincing data, but you won't convince everybody. But a key important thing here is that when the patients were subdivided into whether they were standard risk or at high risk, using fairly predetermined criteria, what was interesting was that the benefit was confined to those with standard risk disease, and there was no benefit in those with high risk disease. But when we look at the relapse rate, there's certainly a considerable reduction in relapse rate in those both with standard and high risk disease. So the possession of a donor considerably reduces the relapse risk. But the main problem was that the toxicity. So in the high-risk population, there was an enormous amount of toxicity, so a large number of patients basically succumbed to the allogeneic transplantation. And when this was analysed in detail, older age, greater than 35 years, was the only factor that could be statistically shown to be independently responsible for the failure to benefit from having a donor in the high-risk group. And that's quite an interesting thing, because age less than 35 is a sort of also the target age range for now being an AYA. So that almost, you know, it almost rules out allogeneic transplant. So it's an interesting thing. So in such circumstances, should we reserve allogeneic transplant for relapse? So this is some data again from the same trial. This shows the outcome of more than 600 adult patients after relapse. And as you can see, the overall survival of these individuals after relapse is exceedingly poor. So if you do have an allogeneic transplant strategy, there's no point reserving it to relapse. Allogeneic transplant rescued a few patients after relapse. There were almost no long-term survivors of a chemotherapy alone approach. If allogeneic transplant could be applied after relapse, there was a worthwhile outcome. But nonetheless, it's not worth reserving your allo. I think it works in kids, but it doesn't work in adults. So given all of the issues, we've shown that older adults have a poor outcome with conventional chemotherapy. They have different genetics and they have a very poor tolerance, and they're much more likely to die during induction. We know that minimal residual disease is a very sensitive technique, providing a very good assessment of response. And it somehow gets around the fact that we don't properly understand the biology, because it takes into account the biology and the treatment responsiveness. We can show that myeloablative allogeneic transplantation is too toxic above a certain age. We can show that reservation of allograft until after an adult has relapsed doesn't make any sense, because they're almost impossible to rescue. But we really don't know for sure if reduced intensity conditioned allografting has a role. And in particular, what we don't know is, does older age alone confer a sufficiently high risk of relapse to recommend reduced intensity conditioned allograft in all cases? So in the UK, as I'll show you, we've taken been a rather bold move to say that that should be our hypothesis, but I'm by no means suggesting that that's the right thing to do. I'm just suggesting that's the hypothesis that we have chosen to test. Now, there are many difficulties these days in studying the role of allograft in ALL. Firstly, it's very difficult to design a suitable trial. So you don't really have equipoise. There's never really been a randomized controlled trial with allogeneic transplantation as an arm. And these days, it's impossible to do a donor versus no donor analysis, because if you can't find a sibling donor, you can almost always find some sort of donor. And again, what's some sort of donor? What is a donor? So you can't do those things anymore. If you look at retrospective studies, there's always an incredible selection bias. So there's lots of transplant-only studies from single centres or from fantastic databases such as the EBMT or the IBMTR, but they don't include a denominator, so you've got no idea how many people of the same type did not end up getting a transplant. So the benefit that you see in these studies only applies to the people selected for reporting and doesn't allow you to make a judgment about whether that's the right thing to do with a new patient in front of you. And even in prospective studies, immortal time bias is quite an issue. So a patient getting a transplant in a study of ALL is guaranteed to have entered complete remission and survived disease-free by the time of transplant. And so you've got to be really careful in interpreting analyses by treatment received, even in prospective studies, because there's almost always a difference between those who did and did not get a transplant, and that difference is rarely random. So having said all of that, this is a summary of current publications on reduced intensity conditioning transplants in ALL. And there's a few things I need to point out. So first of all, some of these were single centre or multi-centre studies, but quite a lot of them are single centre studies. The number of patients included in those studies is relatively small. There's a wide variety of conditioning regimens, and I think we all know that a transplant isn't a transplant. You know, what you actually do during the transplant is of key importance. In cases where the patients had Philadelphia positive ALL, there was a variety of approaches as to whether these patients received tyrosine kinase inhibitors. And one thing that I think is particularly important as a person who looks after adults, in particular older adults, there was a huge number of patients developed chronic graft versus host disease. So even if you're cured of ALL, you've then been substituted with a very debilitating and potentially life-threatening disease all and of its own. And another thing which is very important is none of those studies reported good outcomes in patients beyond first complete remission. So it's still a thing that if you have chemotherapy and you lapse and you're an older individual, I think there's still an idea to try and get you through to reduced intensity condition transplant. But by and large, the outcomes in that situation are generally quite poor. There have been two recent retrospective comparative studies using the large registry data, the IBMTR data and EBMT, and they've made some kind of attempt to compare reduced intensity with myeloablative conditioning. Interestingly, although they both had large numbers of patients in them, they came out with slightly different ideas. This one included sibling and unrelated donors of all ages. The EBMT study only looked at sibling donors and patients over 45 years. And they differed in whether there was an increased risk of relapse after reduced intensity conditioning. They differed in whether there was a reduction in treatment-related mortality. And they differed in whether the conditioning regimen was significant. So it was very difficult, even from these very large studies, to pull out the salient features. So what about prospective studies of reduced intensity conditioning in ALL? So there are two such prospective studies. One is from the HOVON, the Dutch-Belgian cooperative group, the HOVON 100 study, and the other is from UCAL14, which is a current ongoing trial in the United Kingdom. And both of those studies are quite bravely, have assigned patients to reduce intensity condition transplant at an age cutoff of 40. And again, it's somewhat arbitrary, as our data in UCAL14 suggested that patients over the age of 35 were not going to be able to tolerate myeloablative conditioning. But we also felt that our physicians were going to not tolerate having 35 as a cutoff. So we chose 40 as a kind of a compromise, really, because we wanted people to enter patients into the protocol and not do their own own thing. But both of these protocols, in both of these protocols, all patients get an allogeneic transplantation despite their risk status, if a sibling donor is available, and if the patients are poor risk, and I'll show you the risk features in a minute, you can use an unrelated donor. And this is the HOVON 100. We don't need to dwell too much on the protocol, but just say that all patients get reduced intensity condition transplant if they're over 40 years. And I think this probably is going to be the first study to report, because they are, I think they finished this trial and they'll be soon analysing the data. In our trial in the UK, UCAL 14, we assess patients at the end of induction. I'll tell you what the risk assessment is here. And for all patients who are high risk, they go on to get a myeloablative or a reduced intensity condition transplant based on age. And I think this is a bold thing that we did. High-risk criteria are really quite old-fashioned. They're conventional criteria. But one key thing is that we've put age over 40 as a high-risk criteria in and of itself. So if you're over 40 years of age, even if you don't have any of the other high-risk features, at the present time in our trial, you are assigned to have a reduced intensity condition transplant. And that, I'm not saying outside of a trial, I wouldn't necessarily recommend that as an approach for a patient, but we've got to ask that question. So I don't say that's the right thing to do, but we're going to try and find out whether that's the right thing to do. The conditioning regimen that we're using, again, is an interesting choice. We choose fludarabine and melphalan, which is a very commonly used conditioning regimen for reduced intensity condition transplants. But we also include a modest dose of alemtuzumab, Campath, for a modest amount of in vivo T-cell depletion. The dose that we chose was based on some studies reducing the dose of Campath. So we want to try and make sure these patients they have some risk of getting GVHD, but not the high kind of 80% risk of getting chronic GVHD that was reported in the fludarabine and melphalan alone. Patients receive cyclosporin for up to 3 months. And then, interestingly, we're following all patients incredibly closely for multilineage chimerism and MRD. So at three-monthly intervals, all patients are having their MRD quantified and they're having their multilineage chimerism done. And if patients are mixed chimeras in the T-cell lineage or they are MRD positive, they're having stepwise administration of DLI. And that's going to be a rich source of data, actually, because we've got an enormous amount of follow-up material from all these patients who've had multiple samplings. So far, we've recruited 300. Well, this is the time we've recruited nearly 400, but at the time of the analysis here, we'd recruited 300 patients, and 188 of those patients were more than 40 years of age, and the median age of the over 40s was 54. So this is a very different population to the one that you mostly are used to seeing. Quite a lot of these patients had high-risk cytogenetics, and some of them had poorer performance statuses at diagnosis, which I assume is relatively uncommon in children. What's already very interesting, out of 188 patients who were assigned to allograft, 65 of them didn't actually receive the allograft. And one of the main reasons for patients not receiving an allograft is that they've died during induction, either of treatment-related mortality or, unfortunately, didn't respond and died of ALL, and other sorts of toxicity or relapse prior to getting the transplant is also very common. So it's a common issue in treating older adults that no matter what you plan to do, what you've already done to them, or the disease may intervene and prevent you from carrying out what you plan to do. And so at the point of the analysis that was done here, we only had 32 patients on who we had enough data reported to discuss. And I guess the only thing that I can say about these things, out of these individuals, 100% of them did actually make it through and got out of hospital. So there were no early toxicities. I don't have the updated curve to show you, but of the patients who did receive allogeneic transplantation, with the caveat I've just said about interpretation by treatment received, there's something like an 80% survival at about 18 months. So it looks like things are going okay for these individuals, but you've got to bear in mind that a lot of the individuals didn't even manage to receive the approach that was assigned to them. And so when we do that analysis, we'll have to be really careful in reporting intention to treat. So what I think is that there's going to be a lot of competition from non-transplant immunotherapies, and this may be a more sensible thing to do. If we can positively impact outcomes with novel agents which include immunological approaches, transplantation may become unnecessary. We may be able to achieve a graft versus leukemia without GVHD. And I just want to refer to one particular piece of data on blinatumomab. In this paper here, published by Max Topp in Blood, this refers to patients who received blinatumomab when they were MRD positive. So patients who had undergone conditioning and were not in HADO, they had normal blood counts and no overt ALL, but they were MRD positive. And what's very interesting is this is the outcome for all patients. Some of these went on to receive transplant, but quite a few of these patients did not go on to receive subsequent transplant. And we know that there's patients who have MRD positive ALL and adults do very poorly, but there's a group of people here that didn't go on and receive a transplant, and there appears to be a stable curve. So we may be able to do a lot better. And my great hope one day would be able to treat ALL completely with an absolutely chemotherapy-free approach. And, you know, hopefully, because I don't think this idea of pushing chemotherapy is really going to help older individuals. It's helped children to some extent in the sense that children are routinely cured of ALL, but it's a very burdensome treatment and it's very toxic. But right at this moment, nobody's going to stop doing that in kids because it works, in inverted commas. So what I think is that research in older adults is then now going to lead the way, because if we can show these approaches are going to be beneficial, we're only going to be able to do it in older adults, because nobody's going to take away some treatment from a kid who's got a 98% chance of 5-year overall survival. But people would be very happy to add in treatment to a 60-year-old who's got a 10% chance of 5-year overall survival. So in conclusion, I think allogeneic transplant decisions in ALL are really not straightforward, and they need constant reconsideration in the light of new evidence that doesn't necessarily relate to transplantation itself. And we should routinely be making the best use of risk evaluations such as minimal residual disease determination to help direct therapy and properly monitor its outcome. And I think increasing understanding of the treatment-related mortality of myeloablative allografting in older individuals has led to a much greater use of reduced intensity conditioning approaches, but with very little evidence-based. And chronic toxicity of allografting, in particular graft versus host disease, is a huge issue. And so obviously prospective studies are ongoing, and I hope we'll be able to answer some of these questions. I'd very much like to thank and acknowledge all the centres. We've got 70 centres in the UK participating in our trial. We routinely recruit more than 80% of the available population, which is partly due to the fact that we have socialized medicine. So I really hope you manage to achieve that in the United States, because it massively, massively impacts how patients can get treated and trial recruitment. I want to thank CRUK for funding our trial, all the members of my group, our partners and collaborators, ECOG for a fantastic collaboration on UCAL12, and we work with the European Study Group for MRD monitoring. So if there's any rogue labs from the United States, there's lots of countries out of Europe who do join that, so if anybody fancies joining the European Study Group, you'd be really welcome. It's a great place to cooperate on MRD approaches. Thank you for your attention.